हेलो, गुड इवनिंग व्यूअर्स. दिस इज हिमांशु निर्बाण एंड यू आर ऑन माय यूट्यूब चैनल द इंडियन वेदर. एंड राइट नाउ वी आर बीइंग जॉइंड बाय वन ऑफ द मोस्ट डेकोरेटेड जनरल्स ऑफ द इंडियन आर्मी. ही इज मिस्टर रिटायर्ड हर्षा कक्कड़ सर. ही इज अ वेरी पर्सन, ही इज वेरी लाइक सीनियर मोस्ट रिटायर्ड जनरल फ्रॉम द इंडियन आर्मी एंड ही इज मोस्टली एक्टिव ऑन ट्विटर एंड यू कैन see the sir's presence like on the international and national topics related to India. Welcome, sir. Welcome to our show.
Thank you.
Sir, first of all, I would like to ask a few things. This video session will be on today of relation with India, with Pakistan and China and the some kind of external affairs. Okay, sir. So, sir, first of all, my first question to you is that, sir, how do you see like the recent skirmishes of, going on the LOC? Like recent yesterday or day before yesterday, we lost about 3 or 4 jawans on the LOC in the shelling and the like this infiltration of terrorists from the Pakistani side. So, how do you see that, sir? Will it stop one day, or is it possible to stop all these infiltration bits?
When you look at the LOC is basically got a fencing which is cut in various places on account of the terror.
Okay, sir.
Now, as long as Pakistan will, for Pakistan, it is a fairly cheap way of keeping the Indian Army engaged. There is also an interest from China to keep Kashmir active. So with that sort of a scenario, it is unlikely to end soon. It is something we will have to continue handling. And the aspect is that if it has to end, then it has to end only provided there are talks between the two countries, which is
okay.
So in all probability, we will see the situation continuing the way it is, at least for some time more. The difference is that as long as you continue hitting them hard, punishing them for every attempt that they make in terms of ceasefire violation or infiltration. Continue reducing. And that is what is the state today. There are barely about 20-25 Pakistani trained terrorists in the valley. That figure is also receding by the day. So it is something that we've been able to achieve over a period of time. And hopefully we will continue reducing it more, thereby pushing them harder and compelling them to sort of use this attempt that they make.
Okay, sir. Sir, how do you see like recently there is a row of surrendering terrorists in the Kashmir Valley? Means very few terrorists who have joined in the recent past in about 2 or 3 months into the terrorism that is spreading in the Kashmir Valley. Most of them, like not most of them, only few of them have returned to the normal life. Like they are surrendering. So how do you see like why are the local youth of Kashmir is joining the terrorism instead of joining some kind of employment activity?
The reason is that there is a lot of misguidance which is happening, and there's a lot of misinformation which is flowing. Plus the overground workers try and convince them that this is the only way. It is only after the individual joins that he realizes it's a mistake. And that mistake realization is slowly increasing. And people are coming back into the mainstream. You will find with passage of time, possibly the lot returning will be much more. And as and when this happens, there will start getting to be a change in the valley. That is something which each one who surrenders, he's being highlighted, he's being looked after, he's being moved out so that he's not a target. So there are, once the confidence starts coming in that we will not be maltreated, we will not be punished for having joined the militancy, we will find a lot more returning. That is something which the forces are now moving towards.
So, sir, I would like to know, and my viewers also would like to know, sir, that how is the procedure of, like, after surrendering of these terrorists, so what are the welfare schemes being given to them? Like, are they being allowed to join the armed forces, or are they allowed just to as a government job, they are offered like government jobs or like what are the rehabilitation schemes for these terrorists that they are surrendering?
There is nothing at the moment. The government is reworking on its later schemes. Earlier, there was some which was allocated, which was kept in a fixed deposit given to them after a period of time, provided during a period of time they did not move into terrorism. In some cases, students, so they were sent out of the state to study. There is nothing like they are taken into the army or into the state government.
Okay.
There are methods by which they are moved out of the region. There are methods wherein they are provided with some sort of funds to start a small city. And in that case also, the funds are normally kept secure and locked so that they cannot use the funds for other activities. So measures that are taken. Main aim is to ensure he doesn't go back into terrorism. The second is to ensure that what was his profession before terrorism, he goes back into it. Third is to secure his life from terrorists who would like to hit him back, basically to send a message that you must not leave terrorism. So these are measures which are required to be taken, and they are being taken, and that is something which is good.
Sir, how would you see, like, whenever a person in the Kashmir Valley, if he is coming on this various social media platforms, why do you think that they are just speaking about the anti-India sentiments each and every time? Like, are they being paid by the ISI, which is working across the line of control in Pakistan, or are like they are only the local boys who are just being misguided to spread hatred into the Indian society? How do you think, sir?
You see them on social media, you don't know whether he's from Kashmir or from or a handle from across. We believe they are Kashmiris, but it is not so. In most cases, they are fake handles and they are being placed from across to spread the message. That is what is the action. In Kashmir, there is a sort of anger, but it is not so much can boil over. Otherwise, we would have been regularly facing riots and other issues, which are not there. There is a relative peace, there is calm, there is improvement, there is development. So, and plus now with the government planning on the local elections, including the District Development Council, the municipal elections, and the Panchayat elections, it means the situation is fairly good. So what you generally get to a large extent are handlers from Pakistan. There would be a few disgruntled also. I would not deny that. But largely, it is from across.
Sir, as per to the recent things, like recent news we are getting in from different news outlets and from our local sources, that there is a shortage of weapons, arms and ammunition in this terrorist handlers. They are not able to retrieve the weapons, and also the people who were just like looting the weapons from the security force are either running away from the government offices, and all these things. And first of all, like another thing has been going on in recent days, like the dropping of weapons from the Pakistan end using drones. So, sir, how do you see it? Like this shortage of weapons is really hampering the terrorism spread in Kashmir?
A shortage of weapons will hamper terrorism spread, because without weapons, a terrorist is valueless. And even if you have a weapon, unless you train him, he's actually valueless. He doesn't know how to utilize it. So these are the shortfalls of local terrorism. And which is why they used to use their own side-trained terrorists to infiltrate, which is now being prevented. So with this happening, the situation is that is one of the reasons why the situation is fast returning to normal. And with the shortage of weapons, Pakistan is trying different means, whether it is through the border from down, where they try and send in through the trucks which are crossing over with food, and with a trade means, which is all zero now. Or they're trying to use tunnels to push in weapons or drones. Because without weapons, the militancy will die a natural death. So this is another action which has been taken from our side. So Pak is trying to counter it. It is a game which will carry on for some time. And as and when the weapons shortage is really felt, you find militancy automatically reducing.
Sir, like In between, there was some kind of confiscation of the weapons also, and many weapons were found to be made in China. So do you think like China is involved in the terror activities, either the Chinese authorities are supporting the Pakistani terrorists to either to involve or just to make the Indian Army to be involved in on the LOC only, not that much involved on the LAC?
As far as China is concerned, as long as it is active in Kashmir, it is a benefit to them.
Mm-hmm.
But what we don't know for certain is whether they are providing the weapons or Pakistan is buying the weapons from the cheapest possible source. So that is something which we don't know. But in all probability, China indirectly would be involved, definitely, because for them it is a benefit that is here. And the weapons that are available, these are available across the world, whether you look at it in Syria, in Afghanistan, wherever you want, the same weapons are available. But those who manufacture it are willing to sell it to anyone. And you'll find the weapons also in any place wherever there is an insurgency. So directly to state that China is providing it free of cost without proof is slightly difficult. But definitely China has an interest in keeping the militancy in Kashmir active.
So, sir, how would you think like right now the politics in Pakistan is hampering the government of Mr. Imran Khan? And in the recent weeks, we have seen mass protests against Mr. Imran Khan. And there are some speculations that an army is going to dislodge him from his actual position and is going to bring Mr. Nawaz Sharif back. So how do you see, is there any probability between these two theories that is being going on?
One doesn't know for certain, but definitely the PDM movement, the People's Democratic Movement, is gaining steam. It is gaining strength. It is gaining support. Now, how will that play out? We'll come to know maybe in the next month or two. But at the same time, there is a lot of pressure on Imran Khan. There's a lot of pressure on the army, which is why the army conducted the investigation into the Karachi incident. It has sacked people. Today, when they wanted to brief the members of the different political parties, they were to brief them tomorrow. They've refused to attend, so the meeting is postponed. So there is a game going on between the opposition political parties and the government, as also the army on one side. So how will it play out? We need to observe, we need to be patient, we need to watch how the situation builds. The next rally is on the 23rd of the month or 28th of the month.
Yes.
And then is March, which is there towards Islamabad in January. How much pressure they're able to apply? How are they able to act? How much will Imran Khan or the army be willing to take? We'll have to see how the situation develops. But it is a situation which is building up and is getting to be difficult for both the army and Imran Khan.
Okay, sir. So my next question to you is regarding to the recent developments in the POK. In the recent days, Pakistan has provided the provincial nomination to the POK, to the Gilgit-Baltistan area. So how do you think that this gamble is going to work?
It has not yet provided. It is planning to provide.
Yeah.
For that, it needs political support, which is why the army was to brief the members of the opposition tomorrow, which has been postponed. The POK government is objecting to it. Some political parties are objecting to it because they don't want the army involved in the discussion. There are issues that are there, because if Pakistan has also got to look at it from the from their claims on Kashmir, because if they do this, then their claims on Kashmir come to an end. So there are issues that are involved. And within Pakistan, there is an anger that you cannot do this, because then POK will lose its status. After all, they're looking at a separate Kashmir. Within India, Hurriyat is also objecting, and Hurriyat is supposed to be supported by Pakistan. So there are lots of objections to this. They have yet to take a decision. They're holding elections in Pakistan on the 15th. After that, they are supposed to take a call. Will they take a call? Will the Pak Parliament agree? Will the opposition agree? Will the POK government agree? There are many issues that are still being sorted out within Pakistan itself. But they also know that if they do this action, then they will lose the battle that they are so far trying to project across the world on Kashmir. So that is where the whole game is. So we'll see how they take a call. What do they do? Because for India, it is going against the rule, because Gilgit-Baltistan is a part of Kashmir, and it is part of the part of India. So they will be going against the global norm.
Sir, how do you see, like, there were recent revolt kind of situation in the Gilgit-Baltistan area? Means many kind of human rights violation is being blamed on the local authorities and against the Pakistan army. And Pakistan army is like killing or like arresting those who are like asking for general human rights. Means, so how do you see, like, are people of Gilgit-Baltistan have got fed up from this Pakistan rule and they want to get attention towards India, that should India take a move and to capture this area as per to their public interest? Is it feasible right now or in the near future, sir? How do you see?
As of now, we are observing what is going on. If the situation builds up, it will depend how it builds up within Gilgit-Baltistan. How do the protests go? Because the protests are not so, are not that strong that they could rattle the Pak government.
Okay.
And it is, after all, you have to realize that Gilgit-Baltistan comprises generally of Shias and Pak is generally a Sunni country.
Okay,
so it is also an issue there. So, and Gilgit-Baltistan not being a province is almost directly controlled by the Pak army. China has major investments there. So there is no way that Pakistan would want Gilgit-Baltistan situation to go out of hand, because the investments of China in the CPEC, the new dams that China is going to be building in the region. And that is what people are objecting against, because they don't want the dams that will spoil, that will relocate a lot of villages, take away a lot of land. So there are multiple issues that are coming in there. The way it will all depend on how Pak acts, what decision it takes in terms of Gilgit-Baltistan, whether it will permit the violence to continue, how much does it subdue it. These are aspects which will take time. But in all probability, the people are unhappy. There is no development there. There is nothing which is happening to those people. They have no benefits of the state. They're treated as outsiders. So there is a latent anger. And that is the status where it stands now. Again, see, these are things which are moving. So to immediately judge as to what the future will be actually jumping too far ahead.
So, sir, how, move on to a China-Pakistan aspect. Sir, about 2 or 3 days back, we got a news that Pakistan is lending 2 islands, which are situated in the Arabian Sea, in the run of Kutch, near run of Kutch, to China, being mocked as based on development of those islands. So how do you see, will China is planning to surround India from all 4 sides in the Indian Ocean and Arabian Sea area?
See, how will those islands develop? Will they become a naval base? Will they be used for something? As of now, nothing is known. Are they suitable for ships to come and plonk? Is there a space enough for them to make the docks for the ship to come? Is it going to be a military development? Is it going to be an economic development? Can Pakistan do it without the people of Sindh objecting, which they already are? Because if they are objecting and you attempt to do this, then you will have more problems within Pakistan. So it is still early stages. They have yet to take over the islands from the Sindh government. They have yet to contemplate. It is only a thought process that it will be given to China, because Pakistan cannot repay China for what it is investing.
Yes, sir.
It may come as one of the options, but the major factor is what will happen to the islands is what we need to see. If it becomes a naval base, yes, it will be a threat to India. If it is not a naval base, it is being used for something else, then it may not be a threat to India. That is something which we would have to see. And Chinese bases are there in and around, but you've got to realize a base is where a ship will come, but your main stop come from the China mainland. And Chinese mainland is 3,000 kilometers
away. So, sir, my question to you for the relation thing between what Pakistan is facing right now the economics crisis. Like the people of Pakistan are dying and they don't have enough food to eat. The wheat, the pulses have gone to a height of extent. And Pakistan government has been indulged in different situations all around the globe, like in Azerbaijan, Armenia war, Pakistan has been involved. And and on the other hand, for the Kashmir issues, they are just supporting Turkey, and Turkey is supporting them, means the Pakistanis. But as far as the money has been concerned, yesterday only, Saudi Arabia demanded for the $2 billion back from Pakistan. So how do you see, like, Saudi Arabia and the Gulf countries are being supporting India in its move, or either they are boycotting the Turkish move that the Pakistan is going through?
They're doing both. One is they're supporting it. They're applying pressure on Pakistan, its policies. Pakistan feels it's got the support of Turkey, but Turkey cannot help it economically. China cannot keep giving money. There is some stage when China will stop. How does Pakistan repay? Where does it get? As long as it's on the gray list, even the IMF will not give it full loan. So in this status, it is Pakistan which is facing a crisis. It has chosen Turkey to, as a new friend, and in lieu of Saudi Arabia. But then that appears to be a wrong decision because it is not going to get economic assistance from there. So that is where it is going to have a problem. And as long as Saudi Arabia keeps taking back whatever it has given to Pakistan, it's Pakistan that's going to face a problem. So these are the problems that are going to come up. And as far as that is concerned, it is not going to get help from elsewhere. So it will at some stage of time have to take a rethink on whether its current policy of sticking close to Turkey is right or wrong.
So, sir, how would you see, like, the Turkish involvement in the Kashmir issue? Like, to the recent past, Turkey has, like, suddenly increased its support for the Kashmiri movement. Means they are funding the local Kashmiri youths, and they are paying the scholarships. Like, how do you see, like, is Turkey being involved in the terror activities also? Are they financing the terror activities in India? And should India make a common move against the enemies that Turkey, Turkey seems enemies, like, should India move for the Kurdish region of Syria and Iraq? Should India support the Kurds against their movement against Turkey? How do you, sir, the relation?
See, Turkey is offering scholarship is one factor. Whether it is funding is unlikely because Turkey itself is facing severe economic crisis. It is downvaluing its own lira, its own currency, to the level that it is in a deep economic crisis at the moment. It is unlikely that Turkey can do much. It is only verbal support, which is what it is providing. Nothing beyond that. As far as India is concerned, India is developing Greece and other countries with whom Turkey has a problem. So that is anyway happening. And as long as we are doing it, they will also do it. But there's not much that Turkey can do except support Pakistan in the international forums, which is nothing much because Turkey itself is facing its own problems. So, and it is not a major player that anyone in the world listens to it. So with that sort of a situation, it is only a pinprick as far as India is concerned, nothing very major.
Okay. Sir, my next question to you is, like, is about the Chinese involvement in the Ladakh region. Like, since May, when China has occupied some kind of territory, according to their own legends, that they have crossed their own side of LAC. And our opposition members and opposition parties are believing that about 1,000 square miles of Indian land has been occupied by the China. So is it true that China has occupied this much of land, or it's a fake false statements being given to demoralize the people of India by the opposition members, or to defame the Indian army?
I'm not going to get into the politics part. The only thing I would say is, if the CDS has said that there is no land taken, or if the defense minister has made a public statement, then I think we need to stick to that.
Okay. So, sir, how do you see like the Chinese involvement in this particular theater of war? Like, there are unpublished reports that China is facing heavy casualties on its side due to the harsh weather conditions of winter. So, how do you see that? Will China take a bold step to attack the Indian positions at the time of winter or not?
You got to realize winter is a very difficult period there. When you stay there, minus 40, you cannot move. Cannot do much. Winter is not the period when you campaign. Whenever you have to campaign, you look for a campaigning period. And the other question is, winter is a period when you're fighting the weather. So it is unlikely that you will do much because any casualties at that time are very difficult to take care of. So unlikely that China would attempt anything. The talks are going on. Let's see how the talks progress. There is a mention that possibly we will discuss all issues in the next session. So let us see how it goes. But winter is a period when it is unlikely for anyone to take any major moves because the period is very difficult. You are battling weather, and weather gods at that time are very, very unfavorable.
So, sir, I would like to ask a few questions about the Indian Army also. Like in the this clashes that occurred in Galwan Valley, after that there was a force namely as the Special Frontier Force, which are mostly been the fighters recruited of are of Tibeti origin. So how do you see that will it make a specific move in the Tibetan region of China? Like, will there be a rebellion kind of thing if any kind of attack occurs from the Chinese end, and this Special Frontier Force are being tasked to defend it. So do you think in the near future there is a possibility of rebellion inside the Tibet region of China?
One cannot say. It is difficult to predict what will happen within Tibet. But definitely the presence of the SFF is a boost to the Tibetans because they are they are local Tibetans, and the fact that they are operating with the Indian Army is a boost to the Tibetans who are still in Tibet. How will they react in case something happens is difficult to predict, but definitely they will be influenced by what is happening, and with the SFF participating, there will be a sort of influence. You've got to realize that the means of communication between India and Tibet is very, very limited. How much inputs flow? How much do they know? Is it by word of mouth? Is it going to be by what means? How much will it spread? These are things that is difficult to know. But in case, yes, there is a means by which all this spreads, you might find a lot of support coming for their own brothers who are fighting with the Indian Army.
Other question is that in the recent days, we have been seeing some kind of assumptions that China is going, like each and every time China is threatening Taiwan. And on the other hand, Taiwan is like looking towards India. So should Indian government should take a move to just to give some sort of importance to Taiwan, or should it only follow the one China policy?
India has already stated that we are looking at enhancing trade ties with China. It has already made the announcement from the government of India's side. So we are already doing it. And we have a representative of the Indian government in China. In we have an Indian government office there. The Taiwanese government has an office in India. So there is regular contact. And if you're looking at enhancing trade ties, I think we are already indicating what we want to do.
Okay. So, sir, my next question to you is related to the recent skirmishes that is been going on. In between the political field and to the armed forces, that procurement of weapons for the Indian Army is not to a that much task, means like it's a very slow process. So how would you see, like, will Make in India campaign will really support the morale and to the weapons supplyment to the Indian armed forces?
Make in India, you need to have a Make in India because you cannot have the army completely depending on international weapons and imports. If it has to be Make in India, then you have to support the Make in India, which is what the government is trying to do now. It is not a process that will take off overnight. It has to be slow and steady. And I think as of now, there are moves that are coming in. And it is slowly starting. And when it starts and it picks up, you'll automatically find a lot of investments coming in, a lot of technology coming in. And that will be a change not only for the defense, but for other fields also. So this is something which is an ongoing process. The government is pushing it. It is working towards it. Let us hope it succeeds, and let us hope that they get a lot more investment in the Make in India as far as the defense sector is concerned.
Sir, as far as the defense sector is concerned, but there was a CAG report once, and it was reported by the Indian Army that due to some faulty ammunition that they had procured from the Ordnance Factory Board, due to that accident occurred and more than 27 Indian Army soldiers martyred and many more got injured. So how do you think that the local production of weapons or explosives or these artillery shells that they are procuring from the Ordnance Factory Board, are they good in use, or should India should ask for the foreign suppliers to provide all those artillery and ammunition?
No, you need not have foreign suppliers. You can even get it from the Indian companies. They're quite capable of making it now. So there is, as it is, you're spreading your orders across, not only on the ORT, but also across to the private concerns. Supplies are coming in from all sides. And there is a need for the OFB to wake up, to do its checks, to ensure that these faults are rectified. Because if they don't, they will happen. The incident that you're talking about is of the mine blast in Pune. Yeah. Sorry, at the Fulgaon ammunition depot. But that happened 3 years back. And after that, though, of course, there are faults in the ammunition, there are objections to the OFB functioning. OFB itself needs to get its own act together. Now they're being corporatized, so hopefully they will now start looking at better production and better quality, because otherwise they will lose out to the private industry. And when they start losing out to the private industry, they will realize that either they will close down or they will have to work hard towards quality control. And we're already moving towards private sector for a lot of ammunition requirements. And that is something good, and that will happen. And that is part of making it.
Yes, sir. So how you see, there are some reports that I have been studying about 1 month. There is an annual report that the suicide rates in the Indian armed forces is on a higher extent. Means in every 6 or 7 days, there is one incident being reported in the different parts of India that a soldier who is long away from his home and performing duties for his country commits suicide. So by killing himself or in a mock fight, he just shoots his other colleagues and then commit suicide. So how do you see, sir, this kind of situation is being going on in the Indian Army? What are the points that you highlight that these are the stress relief that these soldiers commit suicide? What are the points, and how can you, how is it able to curb all these things, sir?
See, suicides, if you look at it, there is no army in the world which doesn't have it. If you look at statistics, you'll find the Indian Army is still far less. That's one factor. Second is, there are problems, whether it is professional, whether it is tensions on account of operating conditions or family. Multiple issues come into play. There are a lot of attempts or a lot of steps that have been taken to curb suicides. And quite a lot of it is successful. However, there are cases where you really don't know when and why. So studies are still in progress as to how do you try and further control it. You have been able to reasonably control suicides, but these are things that happen, and especially in an army of the size of India, where the strength is so large. Overall, if you look at it, the percentages are not high as compared to global percentages, whether it is UK or US or the other global armies. But even one case is painful, even one case hurts. And there is an attempt at every level to try and find out problems, try and resolve problems, try and create a better working environment. And you are trying to do it. That is why you're able to control the rate of suicide. But individually, after all, every individual has a certain level of pressure which he can take. Some can take much more, some take less. And depending on it, you have such cases which come up. There is a hope that possibly with time we'll be able to further control it and possibly eliminate it. But that is not going to be easy. And it is an action which is being attempted, not only in the army, but also in the Central Armed Police Forces, where also you have similar cases.
Yes, sir.
In fact, it's the global armies that face the same problem. So these are things which are being worked on. Everyone is trying their best to try and reduce the pressures, try and reduce the strains. But you can do it to some level, not across. So let us hope that we can still control it further. Though every loss of life is a very painful loss.
So, sir, my next question to you is related to the politicization of the Indian Army. Like many of the politicians are using the terms like Modi ki Sena or Modi's army, or like into the recent moves, like people across part of like Pakistan and other countries, other nations, they are blaming that since the Modi government has taken an oath since 2014, there is a politicization of the Indian Army. Like many RSS workers are being offered jobs in the Indian Army. And so how do you see like all these speculations from across the border? Are these a part of mind games that they are simply having a fifth generation warfare? Or like what are the like joining things? Like how the people are being selected in the Indian Army? How do you think? Like what message you are going to provide to the people that across they are like across the LOC, Pakistani side? What a
nobody,
message!
Nobody is offered a job in the army, please.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
All right. Nobody is offered a job. You don't. Mm-hmm. You are not given a job offer. If you want to join, you go through the process. Right. You are firstly an Indian. You swear allegiance to the flag, irrespective of which government is in power. Right. As a rule, today we all read newspapers. We all have our own views. So you cannot say that this has been going on since 70 years. So you cannot say that the army is supposed to be illiterate, unknowledgeable, should not read newspapers, should not watch news, should not be knowing what is happening. So the moment you know what is happening, automatically you know basics of politics. But that is not politicization. Politicization of the army is nowhere within the system. Today I am retired, I can announce my own political views. I may have it, I may not have it. That is an individual trait.
Yes,
but
sir.
People who want to call it are doing a disservice to the nation and to the forge. The armed forces do not swear allegiance to any individual. This is the Indian Army. It is not the Chinese Army, which swears allegiance to Xi Jinping. Okay.
Yes,
we swear allegiance to the flag. We swear allegiance to the President of India and the government in power, no matter which government it is. That is, we take orders from the government in power, whichever the government is. Whatever the politicians want to say, it is their game. Nobody is interested. Across the border, there is a fear that the armed forces have got a free hand in dealing with whatever is happening across the LLC.
Yes, sir.
So therefore, we feel that this has got a perception of the government. But that is a wrong perception. The fact is that the Indian Army is a voluntary army. Anyone who wants to join goes through the process. If he's found suitable, he's selected. Nobody is telling you to follow a particular political party. Nobody is telling you to vote for somebody. Right. So it is not politicization in any way. You don't discuss politics. You don't discuss who is who. You only discuss what your nation is, and you swear allegiance to the flag and the President of India. That's it.
Yes, sir. So that was the thing only because I know what is the procedure is. It's for the people across the border of Pakistan and for the people across in China means they are like politicizing the way they can harm the image of Indian Army in India. That was the reason, sir, I had asked you. Yeah. Sir, I would like to know a further few things. Like, sir, in the recent weeks, we are seeing developments of Pakistan being it was saved by going into the blacklist, and it has been kept in the grey list until February 2021. So sir, how do you see, like, if Pakistan has been blacklisted, will there will be any kind of chaos, and will the Pakistan army will take advantage of this thing to attack India at any cost of time?
Pakistan needs three votes to stay out of the blacklist. It has already got 3 votes. That is why it is out of the blacklist. The votes are from China, Turkey, and Malaysia. So with 3 votes, it can stay out of the blacklist. So it will remain in the grey list. It cannot go into the blacklist because it has 3 votes. That is what it wants. So it will remain in the grey list. So where will the army come into play? It is already losing a lot because of the grey list. Can we finish it?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Why not?
Any more questions?
No, thank you.
Done?
Thank you very much, sir.
Okay, thank you, Vachu.
Okay,
take
sir.
Care.
Thanks.
Bye.
Take care. Thank you. Bye. Take care, sir. Bye.